Hello and welcome to the Indian Youth Economic Association's The Agenda. This is the first podcast we're airing in 2020, and our focus today will be on numbers, polling, politics, and elections. And who better to discuss these issues than Mr. Yashwant Deshmukh? Welcome, sir.
Pleasure.
We will be discussing today research methodology, we'll be discussing polling, we'll be discussing pollsters, we'll be discussing numbers, and certainly if we're talking about elections, it goes without saying that we will be discussing the upcoming elections in New Delhi. And we'll focus on the elections in Delhi towards the second half, but I want to begin with research methodology and how pollsters have been sort of framing the public narrative, how polling numbers have been affecting the electoral discourse at large. So I want to begin with asking you about the 2016 United States presidential elections. So to take the example of Mr. Nate Silver, right, so he's known as one of the big guys, right? His book sells like hotcakes right after the 2012 election. He predicts all 50 states along with DC absolutely correctly. He gets 2008-2012 elections on point. And then suddenly we see 2016, right, where he effectively, or his platform 538, he says he's the one who gives Donald Trump the least amount of
probability.
So again, he gives him about 28% odd, but his argument is that I've given him the most out of everyone else who's been giving him any probability to win, because everyone else is giving it at about 99% odd to 98, 89 plus to Hillary Clinton. And again, he's trolled for that, but what happens at the end of it is that Trump wins. So, and we were discussing, I'd like you to give your point of view pertaining to certainly pollsters in America, how you dealt with this, how it was dealt with in India, because you've been covering the numbering for the numbers for the United States elections as well. And whether these kind of sort of falls in terms of the quality of reporting, both in terms of accuracy, I think also affects credibility to a large extent. Is this attributable to malaise? Is there an intention by certain outfits, organizations, or closer to a certain candidate or a party to impact the electoral discourse, or perhaps even the democratic outcome? Or is this sheer delusion, right? No connect to the ground, an intellectual yet idiot approach to things. Okay, we know, like, this has never happened, Trump can never win, so we don't need to put in a lot of effort. Obviously, we show that Trump's going to lose. Or perhaps it's the third end, and perhaps the safest bet I'm giving to anyone who predicted it incorrectly, that they were just too bad at their job. So, I think incompetence is perhaps the best leeway we can give to someone who sort of got it wrong. But what would you attribute this to, and what has been your experience about something like this?
Well, 2016, the notion that is in US academia and everywhere is that actually the polls got it right. You see, the national numbers, the polls said that Hillary is going to be 2 points plus to Trump, and that's exactly where she landed. The question was electoral college, whether she is in a position to win the electoral college or not. And when our polls were, we do the tracker there, UPIC voter, you can actually Google, you can see on the Wikipedia page of national polls in 2016. Yeah. So right on the top, you will see our name actually, because we got it right. And we got it trolled big time when we said that, well, Hillary is 2 points plus, but it is Mr. Trump who is likely to carry the electoral college.
Yeah.
The problem was that the moment that UPI put that as a headline, Mr. Trump himself tweeted about it, and you know, that is the last thing any pollster wants, that Mr. Trump is kind of appreciating you for your poll. But nevertheless, that's the thing which happened with us. So we were the only among the two odd pollsters in the entire thing who said that Trump was going to win. One was University of Southern California and I was UPIC voter.
Yeah.
And the issue was that even when Nate, you know, he wrote to me that how is your electoral college thing, is, you know, thing, and your state-wise predictions are remarkably stable, and why you're doing that. So I told him that, you know, it's more like probably because I am coming from India and we are dealing with way too many variables in Indian politics that US seems a bit easier to me to analyze. And besides, we have an algorithm which picks up the trends and can project a state level vote share better. So that algorithm which we use in India was doing much better in US. That was the secret catch up. But he was more likely of an opinion, Nate, that no, if you are not doing a complete poll in one state, it should not be treated as a poll. You know, you should not be doing with your national poll an algorithm and try to project a state. Well, with all humility, I got it right. That's another thing. But yes, the problems remain. But the thing is that at the end of the day, what do you expect from the poll? You know, the national numbers were correct for all the polls. That's the bottom line in US. Yes, their electoral college thing that went out of the window, primarily because majority of the pollsters did not say for four states that it was just too close to call. Okay. You know, that happens because if you are getting a particular trend in one direction, you end up thinking that it will go in that direction. While statistically speaking, if the gap between the two candidates was less than, say, 1 point, one should have simply said that out of the 50, I am giving prediction for 46. These four are just too close to call.
Yes.
So, TCTC, as we say. So TCTC is something which in probably, I would say, overconfidence and hurting, because what happens is that when there are, unlike India, there are hundreds of polls happening. And when the hundreds of polls are going in one direction, it takes a bit of effort to stick your neck out and say something in opposite direction. And as much I would like to take a credit of doing it right, the fact is I did not. It just happened in that way, that because we have a kind of a tracker which is completely, you know, data comes in and the dashboard is automation kind of thing with my algorithm and everything in. So I had given the front end dashboard to my editorial people in US with UPI, and it, data is data, they pick up without any emotion.
That's true.
You know,
that's
so they picked up in the number and they said that Trump is on dashboard, that Trump is getting electoral college majority. And the guy on the desk of UPI at that day, he looked at it and he fired the copy. Okay, now good, bad, or ugly, whatever it was a blessing in disguise that he did fire, because that's the way we got into the news and that's why we got into a bit of trolling, but eventually getting it right. But yes, if it was on me, probably I would not have dared that much. Probably in writing, I would have probably said that, okay, 46 out of 50 are clear. These four are too close to call. So that is where they are. In terms of India, when you call it, the problem is that people don't understand. They understand polling is something which is an absolute science. And the output of the poll, instead of vote share estimates, they tend to look at the seat share estimate. While the seat share estimate has nothing to do with the poll, the science of polling starts and stops at the vote share estimate. That too within the margin of error that is prescribed as per your sampling methodology. So the public education is very low on what to expect from the polls. Media education is big time zero. I mean, I have to deal with the so many senior journalists and editors in particular, I've been dealing for the last 25 years, and I have no sense of happiness in saying that, that actually they are digitally illiterates, big time of media people. When you tell them that, you know, the poll is having plus minus 3% margin of error, they apply the margin of error on the prediction of seat share. That is the kind of data illiteracy in this country. Actually, my average audience who is watching the TV or who is reading the blog or anything is way more understanding than majority of the journalists in this country. So that's a problem, that in India, that we followed the model from Westminster. There is no direct correlation of vote and the seats. The logical thinking says the party A getting more votes should end up getting more seats. That's the logical thing.
Yes.
Sorry, it doesn't happen that way.
Yeah.
That's why 2004 happened.
Yes.
NDA got more votes than the UPA, still Vajpayee lost as the prime minister.
Yes.
Right.
True.
We have seen that in Karnataka, BJP got less votes than the Congress, but still ended up having more seats than the Congress.
Yes.
Right. We have seen in Haryana, BJP having a lead of almost about, roughly about 10 points in vote share, ended up not having the majority. Can you last imagine any election where in a bipolar or a triangular contest, party A in vote share leads by almost about 10 points in votes and is unable to get the majority?
Yeah.
Same thing happened in Gujarat. BJP led over Congress by almost 10% point, but they almost struggled in Gujarat, BJP, you know, because they are now there is a trend that they are leading or winning the some stronghold or urban seat by huge margins.
That's true. That's true.
You know, and losing the semi-urban and rural seat by very small margin. So that skews up the overall vote share. Now you can polling do it by doing the best of the polling, you can get the vote share correct. But to extrapolate that vote share into terms of seats, it's next to impossible unless you are doing a complete individual poll in each and every seat. Yes. That means your universe is not the state, but your universe is that particular seat.
Yes.
So if you are not having that kind of money, if you are not polling that much, it is impossible to get that number correct.
That's true.
With all due credit and all due respect to a very dear colleague of mine who has been getting couple of last polls very correctly, he is actually doing each and every seat because of a certain political client. So he is privileged to have that kind of budget. He is privileged to poll as many seats, those lakhs of samples, so that he can take a call for each and every seat.
Yes.
So good for him, good for anybody. Tomorrow, if you will like to commission me, Yashwant ji, I want to do each and every seat, 70 seats in Delhi. More than happy to do. I would be happy to do 272 wards of Delhi. If you have the money and if you want to commission us, I would be more than happy to do. But till then, the science of the polling stops at the vote share estimates. That's it.
Yeah.
3 or 5 or 10 different agencies or experts or statisticians or sophologists, if you give them the same vote share, they will come with 10 different seat projections.
Yeah.
No two algorithms work in the same way because they look into the previous history and like that and so on and so forth. And this is where it becomes even more difficult when you have a party making a debut. Right. So in Delhi, 5 years back, we all said Aam Aadmi Party is winning, but we could not look into the scale of 67. Why? 2013. Why? Because in 2013, we said that they are polling about 29%.
Yeah.
But we could not think of them winning more than 15 seats. They got up to 29.
Yeah.
Right. Because there was no political history or electoral history of that particular party. So when you have, when you, I mean, you as a student of economics or anybody, you know, they can understand, you work on a projection model, you have a base to apply your things and then you come up with a projection. If there is no base, what exactly you apply on?
That's
so
true.
Considering that you don't have a base and you still get the vote share correct is a big thing. That means from the survey methodology perspective, you are doing it perfectly right. But without any base, the new party, like in Haryana, this guy JJP, first party, we got the vote share correct, but his impact on the individual seats, because he is contesting for the first time, it's impossible to, there is no model under the sun, no model under the sun, which can actually give you an idea how to convert the vote to seats for a party who has never contested before.
Yeah.
You can't. So these things make only, you know, it actually helps you to only improvise further and see that, okay, if I say there is no model, then maybe we should even try to come up with a model which should deal with the debutant parties and understand in the first past the post system how many seats they can actually dent on while you are polling only for a state or a national vote share model.
Yes.
You know, that's where it goes.
That changes skews it quite a lot.
Yeah.
Yes. So, in fact, even with respect to the UK elections, if you look at the SNP numbers
right.
versus the UKIP numbers, right, on one end they're getting 50 odd seats in Scotland, the vote share is barely 3-4 odd percent.
The victory of SNP was clear right on the day of the Brexit vote.
Yeah.
You see, the Brexit, when the day the Brexit votes were in, they got Brexit, I mean, yes, simply because everybody on the other side of the political spectrum was voting for that particular thing.
Yes.
So the yes vote contained the Tories, they contained the Liberal Democrat, the Liberals,
Labour
and Tories. So if they, it's like on any referendum, if BJP and the Congress are on the same side, is that referendum is going to be defeated?
Hmm.
No way.
Yeah.
But as far as the question of Scottish individuality is concerned, all those no voters, they got consolidated.
Yeah.
So the same vote share of the no vote, when it got into the SNP's kitty, while the opposition got divided between Tories and the Labour.
Yeah.
They swept like anything.
Yes, sir.
So that's how it in electoral politics and these things, that's how they work.
So there's an added responsibility on posts in Westminster systems, because they can't just stop at vote share, or they cannot make a leap to the...
They have to stop at the vote.
They must, absolutely.
But you see, in UK, no pollster in UK. I have been trained with Mori. I'm one of those lucky guys, you know, to have got trained personally under Bob Oster.
Oh.
D Sir Bob Foster. Okay. But what I learned in UK election, I mean, that I'm talking about in the 90s, but what I learned there, they do not give seats projections.
Yeah.
Okay.
Not to get the final exit poll.
They give. Yeah. But that's not there. I mean, what they do is that they have statisticians and everybody, but they force the channel to own up that seat projection.
Yeah.
So it works like that, you know, okay, Mori has done this poll and done this exit poll. According to them, Tories are getting these many votes, Labour are getting these many votes, and this should, as per our estimate, translate into these many seats. All right.
Yes.
This is where every pollster stops in UK.
Hmm.
They don't go for the seats. I wish I could do that in India. But unfortunately, my clients in India, they end up asking only the seat share.
Yeah.
And nobody wants to lose the business. So even no matter how hard I try to tell the audience and my client, boss, this is the vote share. Let's talk about the votes. Yeah. Nope. We will talk about the seats. Okay, if you want to give the seats, why don't you give it in the range? No, we will put up the mean number, middle number, and we'll give only the precise number, as if some Jyotishi is telling, itni hi seate aayengi, to bol diya, to bol diya. It doesn't happen that way.
That's true.
You know, they're polls at best, one should take to understand the issues, to understand the broad direction, which way the wind is blowing,
yes,
to understand how people are reacting to leaderships, to the burning elements of our heated discourse, which go on change from time to time, and then to figure out from demographics perspective that in this demography, how much is which section, not just caste. I will come to that caste thing later, but from education perspective, from income perspective, from so many things, urban, rural, semi-urban divide. Where exactly as a society, what are we thinking, where are we heading, what are our priorities? These are the things which are important. 99% of the things in our survey we ask are these socio-economic issues.
Yes.
There is only one or two question which deals with actual politics, which is whom will you vote for? Unfortunately, 99% of the coverage is only given to that one question rather than the remaining questions.